Sumer is the oldest culture of the world, and the Sumerians give us a tremendous insight into the origin of the giants. The Sumerians recorded that the Anunnaki, a race of celestial beings, the children of Anak and Anu, came to the earth and fathered a race of men, who then became the kings of mortal men. But the Book of Enosh gives us even greater insight to the origin of these giants. Enosh recorded that during the life of Jared, sometime between 3550 and 2550 BC, the sons of God came to the earth from heaven. Since we know Satan is the father of all lies, it is likely that Satan himself influenced them to do the deeds they did. He had puffed them up and built their pride, and for this crime of pride against the Lord, they were cast out of the heavenly realm. Angered for being cast out of their heavenly home and jealous of the beautiful new creation of God, they consorted to do ungodly things and swore an oath to each other that each would be equally culpable for the sinful things they were about to do. Their point of entry into the world was Mount Hermon, Israel, upon which they landed. Just as humans have special gifts and abilities and each is unique, so too the angels were unique, and each used their own special gifts for defiling mankind. So each taught mankind the arts which they themselves loved most. The Book of Acts, Chapter 20. So he sent into Macedonia two of them that ministered unto him, Timotheus and Erastus, but he himself stayed in Asia for a season. And the same time there arose no small stir about that way. For a certain man named Demetrius, a silversmith, which had silver shrines for Diana, brought no small gain unto the craftsmen, whom he called together with the workmen of like occupation, and said, Sirs, ye know that by this craft we have our wealth. Moreover, ye see and hear that not alone at Ephesus, but almost throughout all Asia, this Paul hath persuaded and turned away much people, saying that there be no gods, which are made with hands, so that not only this our craft is in danger to be set at naught, but also that the temple of the great goddess Diana should be despised, and her magnificence should be destroyed, whom all Asia and the world worshipeth. And certain of the chief of Asia, which were his friends, sent unto him, desiring him that he would not adventure himself into the theater. Some therefore cried one thing, and some another, for the assembly was confused, and the more part knew not wherefore they were come together. And they drew Alexander out of the multitude, the Jews putting him forward. And they drew Alexander out of the multitude, the Jews putting him forward. And Alexander beckoned with the hand, and would not have made his defense unto the people. But when they knew he was a Jew, all with one voice, about the space of 2 hours, cried out, Great is Diana of the Ephesians. And when the town clerk had appeased the people, he said, Ye men of Ephesus, what man is there that knoweth not that the city of the Ephesians is worshipped of the great goddess Diana, and the image which fell down from Jupiter? Seeing that these things cannot be spoken against, ye ought to be quiet, and do nothing rashly, for ye have brought hither these men, which are neither robbers of churches nor blasphemers of your goddess. Wherefore, if Demetrius and the craftsmen which are with him have a matter against any man, the law is open, and there are deputies. Let them implead one another. The ancient goddess Diana is a depiction of one of the angels God cast from heaven. She is a goddess of animals and hunting, often depicted with a quiver and a bow, sometimes with a deer or a hound. Having heard the gospel of Jesus Christ from the disciples, the Greeks were in an uproar over this goddess, because the craftsmen made a living making idols, graven images of gods to be worshipped. And if all people in the city were to accept the gospel of Jesus Christ, their occupation would be dissolved. They stood to lose everything. despite the fact that the gospel of Jesus Christ has become so prominent in the world, and idolatry has been exposed for what it is. Graven images of ancient gods and goddesses persist in this world. This is one of my most prized possessions. It's an RWS 177 caliber spring piston air rifle. It was manufactured at the Feinberg-Bau factory in what was then West Germany, before the fall of the Berlin Wall. It has extreme accuracy, so high, in fact, that it's more accurate at its perspective range than any firearm in the world. It has a two-stage adjustable trigger. So high is the quality of this air rifle and this brand that it has not depreciated in value one bit since I purchased it in 1987 from a J.C. Penney's catalog at the price of $279. I could sell this gun today for what I paid for it 23 years ago. I love shooting it because it's so cheap to shoot and its accuracy is so extreme. But I intentionally held back a little information about this gun when I described it to you. It's not just an RWS, it's an RWS Diana. And here, inscribed on the barrel, is an image of the goddess Diana. Instead of a bow, she holds an RWS Diana air rifle in her hand. God has given this world over to Satan, and Satan is the ruler of it. And Satan has marked this world as much as he can. Like a dog, urinating on trees, cut out his territory. Until Christ returns, of course. Which won't be long. I still enjoy shooting this gun, despite the fact that it has this image on it, because I don't worship Diana like the ancient Greeks. I worship our Lord Yeshua Christ, Jesus. I consider it a victory to fire this gun, being a Christian, knowing that this image has no bearing on me. Because I am no longer of this world. We Christians are just passers-by. We pass through this world. We are no longer part of it.